Hello everyone, I'm Dmitry with HeraConnects. Welcome to another video. The wait is over for the GTX 1080. Here's our full review. I promise you, you won't be disappointed. And if you want to check out our unboxing video, it will be linked in the description below, along with our GTX 1080 explained to give you some reference and context as to what this card is all about. Plus, our full written review is linked in the description below. Ton more information there, make sure to check it out. The Z9 Neo by Zalman brings all the right features on a budget. With a large windowed side panel, 5 included fans, and an excellent interior layout with super simple cable management. Get it now, link in the description below. So let's begin with specifications. On paper, the new card is seeing a decrease in CUDA cores, texture units, and ROPs compared to a 980 Ti. But have no fear, the Pascal architecture with TSMC's 16nm FinFET process and much improved 8GB of GDDR5X memory all play in harmony to deliver a freakishly fast card with a TDP of 180 watts, so almost doubling the performance of a GTX 980 while only increasing power consumption by 10%. The clock speeds here are quite high, and Nvidia hints that most GTX 1080s will pass the 2 GHz mark when overclocked, giving us an efficient GP104 core, and we think it will only be a matter of time until we see Pascal architecture, GP104s, or some derivative of that in the notebook space, considering the GTX 980's implementation for gaming notebooks. The only thing that's still unknown to us is full specifications of the GTX 1070. Everybody's super excited about that. It will most likely be like a cut down version of the GTX 1080, but it will still somewhat compete with the Titan X or the higher end Maxwell cards. So next is pricing, which has been a topic of confusion since we have MSRP of $599, and then we have the Founders Edition at $699, which Nvidia is treating as the premium card since it features an exclusive power distribution system, improving efficiency between the power supply and the core. Now, many are wondering how and when we'll be able to buy the $599 cheaper GTX 1080, and come launch May 27th, the truth is you may not have a choice. As custom board partners roll out with their, custom coolers, perhaps extra overclock ability somewhere built into the card, that may be a higher price premium than the $699 price point. So it would be interesting to see what type of compromises are we to expect for the cheaper GTX 1080 at $599. And until we see a $599 GTX 1080, we will treat this card as a $699 card, because that's exactly what it is. But moving on from the price point, the redesign in most eyes is seen as a positive move, as the reference shroud hasn't seen anything new since 700 series. I personally love the angular variation of the shroud. It's still a fairly short card at 10.5 inches in length, so case compatibility is standard, even for small form factor PCs. We have a backplate with this linear engravings, which looks awesome, and a pretty discreet model number sticker, which is so appreciated because it isn't slapped in the middle of the backplate to ruin the aesthetic. It's almost hidden. But in the age of RGB lighting, why isn't the illuminated text RGB? This would have been a pretty sweet touch from Nvidia. Now, it only requires a single 8-pin for power, which is one of the many wow factors that we saw during launch, and perhaps we'll see this expanded with custom board partners for, marketing that extra overclock. The I/O consists of 3 DisplayPort 1.4, HDMI 2.0b, and dual link DVI with 4K HDR supported. We still have 2 SLI fingers, and users will be able to run 2-way SLI configuration with Pascal cards, as adding more cards will not result in scaling improvements. And actually, Nvidia is shifting focus away from 3 and 4-way SLI on these Pascal cards. And more on the SLI conversation, what Nvidia is doing with Pascal, a deeper dive into the Pascal architecture with its asynchronous compute, DX12, and many other features. Make sure to check out our article down in the description below. So much information there, awesome stuff. But now, let's get to the benchmarks. So first come 2560 by 1440 gaming results, and our speculations initially were totally on point with this giant leap in performance compared to the high-end Maxwell cards. The minimum frame rate on the GTX 1080 is higher than the average on the 980, with performance increase not just by a few percentage points, but up to 30 plus frames in Star Wars Battlefront, and the minimum increase of 11 frames in Far Cry 4 versus a 980 Ti. Stepping into 4K now, and the trend continues with the 1080 performing consistently across the board with fantastic minimum frame rate at this resolution. That 8GB of VRAM surely is helping. And notice where the Fury X sits in comparison. So there's just no chance it can compete aside from Hitman with similar results. Getting into DX12 testing, well, you can see that red bar is not moving anywhere from the top slot. Even at 4K resolutions, the GTX 1080 is the most powerful single GPU graphics processor ever created. And check out this power consumption, it's well below the 980 Ti, and with such efficiency, we think that two-way SLI will be an extremely popular configuration for, you know, those die-hard enthusiasts. Acoustics are next, and the card is quiet, like previous designs, without coil wind, so that's awesome. And at load, temperatures reach 82 degrees Celsius, which seems to be the ceiling, and the card does in fact throttle when hitting those low temperatures. Frequency staying below 1800 megahertz, which could be the cause of the fan not kicking in until it's a little bit too late, so we can fully expect consistent frequencies with water cooling or just custom coolers and also just custom fan curves with precision software. Which brings us to overclocking, and remember that 2 gigahertz mark that we mentioned earlier? Well, we achieved that. Our Founders Edition card hit 2126 MHz overclock on the core with a decent memory overclock as well. Fan speed was just set at 55% and we were below 60 degrees Celsius. Now, are you ready to see the results? Because we were mind blown to see the performance increase. I mean, look at that minimum in the Rise of the Tomb Raider. While gaining almost 10 extra frames in the Division, which approaches the performance of two GTX 980 Ti's in SLI. Which brings us into conclusion. The GTX 1080 on the performance front is a massive leap compared to high-end Maxwell cards, and it looks like Nvidia has put much needed architectural improvements into Pascal for asynchronous compute for DX12 and VR applications moving forward. It's a fantastic card, and we're giving it the HurricaneX Damn Good and a Damn Good Value Award. Now, we're very eager to see how this new pricing strategy will impact the sales and the distribution of GTX 1080s and 1070s, especially since we don't know when the $599 card will hit the market. But despite that, the graphics card market as we know it has really changed with this launch. You gotta appreciate what Nvidia has done here, what they've accomplished with Pascal, and the roadmap for Pascal looks to be in really good hands. And that would be it for this review. I hope you guys enjoyed it. What do you think of the GTX 1080? I'm sure everybody's super excited to see what the performance will be like on the GTX 1070. So make sure to subscribe to be notified when that will be released somewhere in June. And also, I'll be testing the GTX 1080 in a video production environment for anybody who's interested. So give this video a thumbs up if you want to see that. But I'm Dmitry with HurricaneX. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.